Introduction to optical fibers.
These are the topics we are going to discuss in this module. What is fiber optics? Materials used in optical fibers. Basic structure of optical fiber communication system. Basic building blocks. Advantages, disadvantages, applications, evolution, and operating windows. What is fiber optics basically? Fiber optics is a technology that uses glass or silica to transmit data in the form of light. A fiber optic cable consists of a bundle of glass threads, each of which is capable of transmitting messages modulated onto light waves.
Fundamentals of fiber optics. What makes fiber optic cables better than copper coaxial cables? This is the fiber optic cable you can see here, and this is copper coaxial cables. Why fiber optic cables are preferred over coaxial cables means transmission of optical signals are faster than copper coaxial cables and they possess greater bandwidth. And as frequency increases from kilohertz to megahertz and then to gigahertz, interference of noise and electromagnetic interference becomes higher. So fiber optic cables are less susceptible to noise and electromagnetic interference. Hence, they are more commonly preferred. And fiber optic cables are lighter and thinner, as you can see in this picture, than copper coaxial cables. Fiber optic cables do not generate excess heat. And security wise, if we consider, fiber optic cables are more secure. The sense that it does not radiate energy. So antenna or any detector cannot detect any signals. So it is more difficult to tap fiber optic cables. And maintenance cost is also very less in this case. That is why fiber optic cables are better than copper coaxial cables. Now this shows the maximum transmission distance covered using copper cables and using fiber optic cables. For 100 megabit Ethernet cable, using copper the transmission distance is 100 meters, whereas using fiber optic cables it is 40 kilometers. And using 1 gigabit Ethernet, the transmission distance using copper is 100 meters, using fiber optic cable it is 70 kilometers. And for 10 gigabit Ethernet using copper, the maximum transmission distance is 100 meters, whereas using fiber optic cables it is 80 kilometers. Now let's see the materials used in optical fibers. Optical fibers are most commonly made from silica, that is glass material. But other materials like fluorozirconate, fluoroaluminate and chalcogenide glasses can also be used. Crystalline materials like sapphire can also be used for longer wavelength, infrared or other specialized applications. This shows the basic structure of optical fiber. It consists of three parts. This is the core or the innermost part, surrounded by cladding, and the outermost layer is called buffer or jacket or coating. This video depicts the basic structure of an optical fiber. This is the core medium, thinnermost part, core, cladding and buffer, outermost part. Coming to core, this is the core region or the innermost region. Surrounding layer is called cladding and the outermost layer is called buffer or jacket. Core is generally made of glass and it is a cylindrical rod of dielectric material. The light rays mainly propagate only through the core of the fiber. The radius of the core is denoted by A normally, and the refractive index of core medium is denoted by N1. Next comes the cladding. The cladding layer surrounds the core. The refractive index of cladding is usually denoted by N2, where N1, that is the refractive index of core, is slightly greater than N2. The cladding is also made up of glass or plastic. Now, as I told you, the refractive index of core should be slightly greater than the refractive index of cladding N2. So how N1 is made slightly higher than N2, we'll see now. Addition of dopants like GO2, germanium dioxide, or phosphorus pentoxide to the raw material silica increases the refractive index, and addition of dopants like B2O3 or fluorine to a silica decreases the refractive index. So this makes the refractive index N1 to be higher than N2. Uses of cladding. Cladding is usually provided for mechanical support. It is used for protecting the core and prevents scattering losses. The outermost layer called the buffer or jacket is provided for protecting the fiber. That means it provides extra protection. The material used here is also plastic. The buffer is elastic in nature and also helps in preventing the optical fiber from scattering losses. This graph shows the composition of fiber. Now, by addition of dopants like GeO2 and P2O5, the refractive index slightly increases to 1.47 approximately. And by addition of fluorine and B2O3, the refractive index decreases, you can see here. So this makes changes in the refractive index. The fiber compositions are listed here. GeO2, SiO2 can be the fiber composition for core medium and SiO2 for cladding, or P2O5 or phosphorus pentoxide and silicon dioxide core medium and silicon dioxide cladding medium, and so on. These are the fiber compositions to have the refractive index of cladding to be lesser than that of the refractive index of the core. Let's see the advantages now. Low intermagnetic interference, ultra high bandwidth in terms of terahertz, low loss or attenuation in the range of 0.2 decibel per kilometer, low manufacturing cost, less weight, reliable and durable. Fiber optic cables do not break easily and hence they are maintained easily. So these are the advantages of fiber optic cables. They too have some disadvantages. Installation cost is high in the case of fiber optic cables, and it is not suitable for mobile communication. It is difficult to reconfigure, and if two or more fiber optic cables ought to be joined using splicing technique, it is difficult to splice since they are more fragile than normal wire. This video depicts the basic optical communication system module. This is the transmitter part. The light rays travel inside the core medium of, this is the core medium of the fiber optic cable, and then reaches the receiving end. This shows a block diagram of basic optical communication system. Any communication system needs an information source, a channel, and a receiver. Here the information source can be audio or video signals that has to be converted into electrical signal. So the transducer used here does this job. It converts the audio or video signals into electrical signal and then gives it to the transmitter part. The transmitter part of optical fiber communication system consists of a driver circuit and a light circuit or a light source. This driver circuit carry the electrical signals from the transducer and transfer it to the light source. The light source used here can be LED or laser as shown here. The light source, LED or laser, converts electrical signals into optical signals. When LED and lasers are compared, LED is simple and cheaper compared to laser. Then after getting converted into optical signals, the light rays passes through the fiber optic cables. Here you can see splices and connectors. If fibers are to be joined, then connectors and splices can be used. Splices are used for permanent joints and connectors are used for temporary joints. Fly leads are used to connect the fiber optic cables to the device. This is the receiver part. The receiver part consists of photodetector, amplifier, and then transducer. The photodetector accepts the optical rays and converts it back to electrical signal. The photodiodes used can be pin photodiode or avalanche photodiode. The signal thus getting converted into electrical signal here may be weak, so in order to boost up the signal, these amplifiers are used. And in turn, the optical receiver can have signal restorer to decrease the signal to noise ratio. Then comes the transducer here, which converts the signal back to the original transmitted signal. Major elements of optical fiber link. It gets continued here. For short distance communication, LED sources are used. Multimode step index fiber is preferable, which we'll be discussing in the next module. Then the photodetector used can be pin photodetector, which detects only high light intensity. For long distance communication, semiconductor laser diodes are used. Single mode fiber is preferable, and here avalanche photodiode can be used, which detects low light intensity. This shows splices and connectors. Two fibers are joined here. Splices are used for permanent joints and connectors are used for temporary joints. This video shows amplification and regeneration using copper coaxial cables and fiber. You can see more number of repeaters are placed here in the case of copper cables, whereas less number in this, only one is shown. Less number of repeaters are placed here. The distance of separation is large here in the case of fiber optic cable, whereas the repeaters are placed close together in the case of copper coaxial cables. Coming to applications of optical fibers, it is used in medical field, defense, government, networking, data storage, telecommunications, industry, and broadcast or CATV. Evolution of fiber optic systems. Let's start with the first generation. In the first generation, gallium arsenide semiconductor lasers are used. The bit rate was 45 megabit per second. The spacing between the repeaters was 10 kilometers. And the operating wavelength 0.85 micrometers or 850 nanometers. The attenuation loss was 2 to 3 dB per kilometer in the case of first generation. And then in the second generation, some improvement were made. Indium gallium arsenide phosphide semiconductor material was used. The bit rate slightly increased from 45 megabit per second to 100 megabit per second, and it increased to 1.7 gigabit per second. The repeater spacing here was 50 kilometers, whereas in the first generation it was very closer, that is 10 kilometers. Then operating wavelength here, it is 1.33 micrometer or 1330 nanometer. The loss was 0.4 decibel per kilometer. In the third generation, silica fibers are used. The bit rate 10 gigabit per second. Repeater spacing increased to 100 kilometers. Operating wavelength 1.55 micrometer or 1550 nanometer. Loss 0.2 decibel per kilometer. In the fourth generation, which uses dense wavelength division multiplexing, the bit rate increased to 10 terabit per second to 1.7 gigabit per second. Repeater spacing greater than 10,000 kilometer. Operating wavelength 1.45 micrometer to 1.62 micrometer, and the loss was significantly reduced. In the fifth generation, solitons were used. Indium phosphide semiconductor material is used. The bit rate drastically increased from 40 gigabit per second to 160 gigabit per second. The repeater spacing also increased here from 24 1000 km to 35,000 km range only the repeaters were placed in the fifth generation. The operating wavelength 1.53 micrometer to 1.57 micrometer were used in fifth generation. The loss got enormously reduced, and here dispersion shifted fibers and dispersion flattened fibers were invented in this generation. Look at the graph here. If you consider the attenuation of the loss in the first window, that is between 800 to 950 approximately, the attenuation was minimum here in the first window, right? And the attenuation slightly decreased to this level in the second window, that is in the wavelength region approximately 1330 nanometer, and then slightly it increases and becomes minimum at this point, that is 1550 nanometer approximately in the third window. So this wavelength 1550 nanometer is preferred for fiber optic communication system since the attenuation is very less here. The repeater spacing increases from generation to generation. The loss also gets reduced and transmission bitrate increases from generation to generation as we have discussed just before. After the third generation, the optical amplifier EDFA, erbium doped fiber amplifier was invented, thereby reducing the delay. You can see here the attenuation is minimum. The first operating window was centered at 850 nanometer. The sources used are GaAlAs, that is gallium aluminium arsenide, and the photodetectors, silicon photodetectors. The application is initial telephone system. It is used in telephone systems and intercity applications. Second operating window was centered at 1300 nanometer. The sources used are alloys of indium gallium arsenide phosphide, and photodetectors used are alloys of indium gallium arsenide. The applications are intercity applications and local area networks. The third operating window was centered at 1550 nanometer or 1500 nanometer approximately. The sources used are alloys of indium gallium arsenide phosphide. The photodetectors used are indium gallium arsenide alloy. The applications are undersea transmission links and metropolitan networks. Ray optics. Now let's see the basic laws of ray optics here. Law of reflection. It states that the angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection. If the angle of incidence is theta 1 and the angle of reflection is theta 2, then according to law of reflection, angle theta 1 will be equal to angle theta 2. This shows the law of reflection. Here the angle of incidence is equal to angle of reflection. Next, law of refraction. When light ray passes from one medium to another medium, in this case glass is one medium and air is another medium. When light ray passes from one medium to another medium, as shown here, bending of light occurs. This bending of light is mainly due to change in the speed of light with respect to medium. This is called as refraction. This video depicts law of refraction. You can see the light gets bent here as it travels from one medium to another medium. This table shows the refractive index value and the speed of light in medium. Generally, air and water is considered. You can see the refractive index of air is 1 and the speed of light is shown here. Similarly, the refractive index for water is 1.33 and the speed of light, corresponding speed of light, is here. It is because mainly of this change in the speed of light or variations in the speed of light, where from medium to one medium to another medium, bending of light occurs. Snell's law. Stanislaw states that the ratio of the sines of angles of incidence and refraction is equivalent to the reciprocal of the ratio of the indices of refraction. The formula is theta 1 sine theta 1 by sine theta 2 is equal to n2 by n1, where theta is the angle measured from normal to the boundary and n is the refractive index of the respective medium. Snell's law is mainly used to find the refractive index of unknown material. Critical angle. In this diagram, when light ray passes from the water medium to air medium, that is from denser medium to rarer medium, the refracted ray normally bends away from the normal. And when the incident angle is increased further, the refracted ray travels along the boundary. This occurs when theta 2, that is when the angle of refraction becomes 90 degrees. So the angle of incidence at which the angle of refraction becomes 90 degrees is called the critical angle. The formula for calculating critical angle is shown here. Sin theta c, here theta c is the critical angle, divided by sin 90 is equal to n2 by n1. In degrees, theta c or phi c will be equivalent to sin inverse of n2 by n1. This table shows the refractive index and the critical angles for different mediums: glass, water, perspex and diamond. Total internal reflection. When the angle of incidence is greater than the critical angle, then the ray will not refract, instead it will get reflected into the same medium itself. That is, when the incident angle theta 1 is greater than the critical angle theta c, the light ray will be reflected back to the same medium. Hence, there will not be any light transmission, that is refraction, in the other medium, medium 2. This is called as total internal reflection. This is a main phenomenon that occurs in optical fibers. Conditions for total internal reflection. There are two basic requirements. First one, the medium from which the light is incident must be optically denser than the medium to which it is incident. That is, n2 should always be greater than n1. Second one is, the angle of incidence in the denser medium must be greater than the critical angle of the denser medium with respect to the rarer medium. This shows the total internal reflection. You can see the ray gets reflected back into the same medium. Numerical aperture. Numerical aperture is a figure of merit which represents the light gathering capability of the fiber. There is no dimension, it is a dimensionless number. Its value ranges from 0 to 1. The formula for calculation of numerical aperture is Na is equal to N1 into root of 2 delta, where n1 is the refractive index of the core and delta is the index difference. Acceptance angle. The light ray always propagates inside the core medium of the fiber. If a ray is to be propagated into the core medium, then it should travel with an angle lesser than one angle. That angle is called as the acceptance angle. If a ray goes beyond the acceptor angle, then it will get refracted into the clearing medium. The light rays will not pass into the core medium if the angle of incidence goes beyond the acceptance angle. So the acceptance angle is the maximum angle at which a light ray may enter into the core and propagate it along the core medium. The formula for calculation of acceptance angle is phi A is equal to sine inverse of Na. Na is a numerical aperture. Beyond this acceptance angle, if a light ray passes into the fiber, then it will be reflected back. Acceptance angle can be easily calculated for meridional rays in a step index 5 model. Meridional rays and other types of rays will be discussed further. This shows acceptance cone. This acceptance cone. You can see in this video, the light ray which enters into the fiber within this acceptance cone or within this acceptance angle gets propagated into the core medium smoothly. And the light rays which enter into the core medium beyond the acceptance angle gets leaked out here. The types of rays. There are three different types of rays. The first one is Q rays. You can see the diagram here. The Q rays does not pass through the axis of the fiber, that is to the center of the fiber. Instead, it touches the core cladding boundaries. Hence, it takes a helical path. When it takes a helical path, at each time it touches the core cladding boundary, an angle gamma is made at each reflection. Hence, the total angle becomes 2 gamma. The skew rays reflects off from the core cladding boundaries and again bounces around the outside of the core. They are not confined to a single plane but follow a helical path along the fiber. This angle is gamma, so totally 2 gamma. Since it takes a helical path, the skew rays travel slower. The helical path traced through the fiber gives a change in the direction of 2 gamma at each reflection, where gamma is the angle between the projection of the ray in two dimensions and radius of the fiber core at the point of reflection. Skew rays are more difficult to track because they do not lie in a single plane. And they have greater acceptance angle since because they take maximum possible light ray path. Power loss will be high in this type because many of the skew rays to be trapped inside the fiber are leaky rays. Leaky rays are partially confined to the core and attenuate as the light travels along the optical waveguide. Next is the meridional rays. The meridional rays enters the core and passes through the axis. And each time it enters into the core medium, it touches the boundary, core cladding boundary, and gets reflected back. This phenomenon is total internal reflection as we have discussed before. So multiple total internal reflections takes place inside the fiber, which leads to meridional rays. These rays are confined to the medial plane of the fiber, which are the planes that contain the axis of symmetry of the fiber. Since the meridional ray lies in a single plane, its path is very easy to track and it travels along the fiber. Where the core surface is parallel, it will always be reflected to pass through the center. Meridional rays take comparatively lesser light ray path because of lesser acceptance angle. These rays also travel slower because of total internal reflection. There are two classes of meridional rays. One is bound rays, the other one is unbound rays. Bound rays are trapped inside the core and propagate along the fiber axis, whereas unbound rays are refracted out of the fiber core. This problem will clearly prove that the acceptance angle for skew rays is always greater than the acceptance angle for meridional rays. Consider this problem. An optical fiber in air has numerical aperture of 0.4. Calculate the acceptance angle for meridional and skew rays, which change direction by 100 degrees at each reflection. Now, the acceptance angle for meridional rays in air is calculated using this formula. So, after substituting the value of numerical aperture in this formula, we get the value for acceptance angle as 23.6 degrees. The acceptance angle for skew rays in air is given by this formula. Sine inverse of Na by cos gamma, where gamma is a reflection made at each time it takes a helical path. Now substituting the same value of numerical aperture in this formula, we get the value of acceptance angle as 38.5 degrees. So this clearly proves that the acceptance angle for skew rays is greater than the acceptance angle for meridional rays. The last type of rays is axial rays. The axial ray always travels along the axis of the fiber and stays at the axis all the time. Since it travels along the axis, it travels faster. And the acceptance angle for axial rays is zero. So it rarely takes light ray path. Classification of fibers. Based on modes of propagation, the fibers are classified as single mode fiber and multimode fiber. Based on refractive index profile, the fibers are classified as step index fiber and graded index fiber. Single mode fiber. As you can see here, in single mode fibers, only one mode is allowed to propagate. The core diameter is too small, in the range of 8 micrometers to 12 micrometer. The single mode fibers always takes an axial light ray path. The ray which passes only through the fiber axis is called axial ray path, as we have discussed before. Fundamental mode always travel along the fiber axis or axial path. For single mode operation, the normalized frequency number V is less than or equal to 2.405. And the mode which has zero cutoff frequency is called fundamental mode. Coming to advantages, in this type of fiber, intermodal dispersion is not present, thus more information can be transmitted per unit of time since the dispersion is not present here. This gives single mode fiber higher bandwidth when compared to multimode fibers, hence it is used for long distance transmission. Disadvantages: LED cannot be used here, it is not a suitable light source, hence laser can be used here. Since the diameter of the core is very small, coupling light into the core will be very difficult, and moreover, fabrication process also becomes difficult for this type of fibers. Applications: they are used in telecom networks and CHEV networks. Multimode fiber. Multimode fiber allows many modes to propagate. You can see here many modes are allowed to propagate along the fiber. The light rays are made to propagate in a zigzag manner like this. That is in the meridional rays. The core diameter is larger when compared to single mode fiber because it allows many rays to pass through it. The core diameter lies in the range of 50 micrometer to 200 micrometers. Advantages: fabrication process is easier when compared to the previous case, coupling efficiency is large, and LED is a suitable light source. Disadvantages: intermodal dispersion is present. Applications: used in LAN network, security systems and general fiber networks. This shows a propagation of light in single mode fiber and in multimode fibers. This table gives you an idea of difference between single mode and multimode fibers. Single mode fibers are also called as monomode fiber. In this, only a single ray passes. Here, more than one ray passes. In single mode fiber, ray passes only along the axis. Here, the meridional rays or skew rays. In multimode fibers, the type of rays propagation can be meridional rays or skew rays. Sometimes it is called paraxial rays. Core diameter is small, as shown here, and here the diameter is large. In single mode fibers, intermodal dispersion is not present, whereas in this case, intermodal dispersion is present. Fabrication is difficult, and here fabrication is easy. Coupling efficiency will be very less in single mode fiber, whereas coupling efficiency is large in multimode fibers. Here LED is not suitable, whereas in this case LED is suitable. Now let's see the fiber profiles. Fiber profiles are graphical representation of value of refractive index across the core diameter. There are two basic types of index profiles as shown here. One is the step index profile, the other one is the graded index profile. This is step index profile and this is graded index profile. Now let's see the fiber optic configurations. Single mode step index fiber, multimode step index fiber and multimode graded index fiber are three optic fiber configurations. This shows the configuration of step index fiber. You can see the refractive index is uniform inside the core medium. step index fiber is a cylindrical waveguide core with central or inner core with uniform refractive index N1, as I've told before. The core is surrounded by outer cladding with uniform refractive index N2, where N2 should always be lesser than N1. But there is an abrupt change in the refractive index at the core cladding interface. At the core cladding boundaries, there will be change in the refractive index. The number of moles here, M, is equal to V squared by 2. Propagation of light inside the step index fiber can be axial, meridional and skew rays. The refractive index profile is defined as N of R is equal to N1 when R is lesser than A for core medium and N2 when R is greater than A for cladding medium, where R is the radial distance from fiber axis. Single mode step index fiber. The single mode step index fiber has a central core as here with uniform refractive index. You can see here the refractive index is uniform here with a step change in core cladding. The light ray is propagated inside the fiber through reflection. Single mode fiber is also known as fundamental or monomode fiber. The dimension of the core is 8 to 12 micrometer and for cladding it is 125 micrometer. Here the numerical aperture is constant, the refractive index profile is a step index profile and it is used effectively with time division multiplex and wavelength division multiplex systems operating in 1550 nanometer wavelength region. Multimode step index fiber. The multimode step index fiber is most commonly used type due to larger size. It can be easily manufactured and hence it is less expensive. The core diameter is 50 to 200 micrometers and the cladding 125 to 400 micrometers. Here the ray takes zigzag path, the meridional rays. The core has large aperture and allows more light to enter the cable. The light rays take many paths here and are propagated down the core in a zigzag manner, that is meridional ray. It uses the principle of total internal reflection. Disadvantages: it causes the transmission bandwidth to be small. Hence, it is used in applications requiring distances of less than 1 kilometer. This shows a graded index profile. It takes a parabolic shape here inside the core medium. In the graded index fiber, the refractive index is not uniform within the core as in the case of the previous type. It is highest at the center and decreases smoothly and continuously with distance towards the cladding as I have shown in the diagram before. So the refractive index profile is in the form of parabolic type. The light waves are bent by refraction towards the core axis. They follow a curved path because of change in the refractive index as they move from the center of the core. The parabolic curve is mainly due to the different change in the refractive index. A graded index fiber has high coupling efficiency and higher bandwidth than the step index fiber. The equation is given by N of R is equal to N1 into 1 minus 2 delta R by A the whole power alpha when R is less than A for core medium and N1 into 1 minus 2 delta to the power of half approximately equal to N2 when R is greater than or equal to cladding, where alpha is the profile factor. Multimode graded index fiber. The light ray is propagated through refraction here. It enters the fiber at many different angles. This is mainly suitable for long distance communication. The core diameter is 50 to 100 micrometers and cladding diameter is 125 to 140 micrometers. Multimode graded index fiber. The light rays no longer follow straight lines here, so they follow a parabolic path and gradually bent back towards the center by the continuously declining refractive index. The light rays near the edge of the core takes a longer path but travel faster since the index of refraction is lower. Advantages: it's comparatively cheaper and intermodal dispersion is reduced. This video clearly shows the propagation of light in multimode step index fiber. The refractive index is uniform here inside the core since it is a step index fiber, and you can see many rays are allowed to pass through, so it is multimode step index fiber. This video shows the propagation of light in multimode graded index fiber. The profile is a parabolic profile here. This shows a comparison of fiber structures for a single mode step index fiber. The profile is uniform here, that is refractive index in the core uniform is uniform, and this is multimode step index and multimode graded index. It takes a parabolic shape here. This video shows the path of light inside the core medium for a graded index profile. See, after it touches the core cladding boundary, it takes a parabolic shape here. The light rays bent. Comparison of step index and graded index fiber. The step index fiber, in this case, the core has uniform refractive index with a small step change in core cladding boundary. In the case of graded index fiber, it has high refractive index along the axis and gradually decreased towards the core cladding interface. Here, axial rays, medial rays, and skew rays are used. Here, paraxial rays. In this case, intermodal dispersion is present in MMSI, and here the intermodal dispersion is reduced in multimode graded index fiber. Step index profile, here it is followed, and here graded index profile alpha is a profile factor. Numerical aperture is constant in the case of step index, and numerical aperture is a function of radius in the case of graded index fiber. M is equal to V square by 2 for step index, and M is equal to V square by 4 for graded index fiber. In this case, fabrication is easy, whereas fabrication becomes difficult in the case of graded index fiber. These are the references I refer for this module. Thank you. Have a good day.